Hello, and welcome to this episode of Into the Light. I'm your host, Edina Mauvana. Today we have Will Holmes. Will is a former industry professional. He embarked on a transformative spiritual journey that led him to become the self-proclaimed mayor of OC. He's a builder and a connector, and he is also the mogul of a pop culture and a podcast host. He's on a mission to change the world through powerful conversations and the dissemination of his influential ideas. Will's initiatives and captivating documentary series that's newly created is showcasing his relentless dedication to making a lasting impact. And so he's the upcoming star of the reality show, The New OC. Welcome, Will. Thank you so much for being here.
First of all, I want to meet that guy, whoever we're talking about.
But yeah, who's that guy?
Who is that guy? He sounds awesome.
Mayor of OC.
Right. But thanks for this opportunity to discuss and give some power to conversation and shed some light on some amazing things. And this platform has already been doing that. And so I'm just happy that you found me worthy enough to get on here.
Oh my goodness. Well, thank you so much. Of course, more than worthy. In fact, I am super excited to have you on the show. I think we've already had a couple conversations. We chatted a little bit on Instagram and then had a couple calls. And, you know, I really want to hear a little bit more about this cause. You have a lot of passion around conversations, how conversations can change the world. You said a little bit about how, you know, you see this as how society needs to, you know, keep interacting and keep going. What do you mean about the power of conversation?
Yeah, the power of conversation is so amazing. And I say that in multi, because I'm a multifaceted individual just like yourself. And everyone's trying to spark a conversation. If that's art, if that's podcasting, that's photography, that's videography, that's music, right? And I've been in all these, if you will, mediums of conversation. And so I realized each of those things has a weight, right, to the human experience. And so I realized through, you know, the networking events that I would do with business professionals that we're having conversations. And so even the podcast space really is championing the power of conversation. And that's what we really want to get to. We're not trying to get to the next dollar. We're not trying to get to the next connection, you know, next big opportunity. We want to know that, am I being heard? And is my message getting out there? And so when I finally realized that these past 6 months, which I was been able to trudge the podcast space at a content house, I realized that conversation can change the world. Yeah. People want to understand and feel where we're coming from in a very non-judgmental way. And I feel like podcasts are the catalyst for that medium and any type of medium, creative medium that I've ever been a part of. And so that's why I came up with this mission to change the world through conversation.
Oh my gosh, I love that so much, because that is definitely what drew me to the powerful art of podcasting. Like, as you know, I'm newly launched about a month in. So I've been having these amazing conversations, and it was in fact conversations that like I was having that led me to want to create the podcast. I'm like, I want to document every one of these, you know, the conversations I'm having with these expert partners and these different healers and practitioners and people who do different things to make the world a better place. And it's almost like I want to highlight that knowledge and that information and whatever I can do to bring it into the world. And it sounds like that's what you are here to do, is help us have our voices heard. And there's nothing more powerful than that, right?
Yeah, there's nothing more powerful than that. And you're giving people an experience that is not really always given, right? Because there's podcasts for everything nowadays. Everyone's a podcaster. Everyone's a mogul. Everyone does this. But what you're doing here is so revolutionary, because it's, how do we get to the powerful manifestation? How do we, you know, raise our consciousness level, which is so amazing. And that helped with, you know, my transition get to this point, you know?
Oh, amazing. Yeah. So I particularly enjoy talking about spirituality related issues. So I was like, what better topic to have a podcast on? Cause that's what I want to be talking about. And it sounds like you also, it's like, I don't know if you are part of this spiritually aware community and what people are talking about with the global consciousness awakening. And it's like, we're all under these mandatory spiritual journeys, whether we like it or not.
There's major shifts that are happening and that we just have to be aware of. And even when I connected with you, and even this past, a lot of people in this past February had a lot of closures and a lot of beginnings. And that was the same thing for me. Being at my birthday was in March. I had a lot of closures and a lot of brand new opportunities that I had to, you know, lean into. And so I believe that that global consciousness, that Christ consciousness that we're all tapping into is needed, you know?
Oh, amazing. Me too. And then you start to realize that everything that the astrologers are talking about is like, oh, this portal energy and this, you know, 11-11 is like, and this, you know, your Mercury in retrograde, and you're like, wow, this is
it's a real thing. It wasn't that amazing. Like, even I was telling somebody, it's crazy you brought that up, because literally, like, that retrograde season before September, right, it was like the worst time. It was like rainy, it was like everybody was feeling it, and I'm like, dude, I was like, we make fun of it, but maybe that retrograde energy, there is a thing to it, you know? And you don't realize it till you're like actually right in it and like aware. And I think that's important, is having an awareness, right? And people, you know, shows like this and people like yourself are providing that awareness, you know, for that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so tell me a little bit about your background. Like, where did you have a specific religious or spiritual background, you know, growing up, or how?
I am a believer, you know, been a believer all my life, non-denominational believer. And so I've been taught and trained in the ways of that, but I had an
awakening. That's Christian specifically.
So I had that. And then I connected, I want to say in 2019 with Zamir, right? And we started going down like the angel number path and
You know,
getting into more spirituality. And I was like, these are actual tools that I can use along with, right? What I'm already doing in the meditations and all those different things. And, you know, co-creating with Creator, and like, we get to do these things. And it changed my life drastically, you know, and saying, dear God, dear universe, like it really opened up a whole new pathway than I had already previously been taught, which opened up my way to connecting to other people, you know, that I possibly just wasn't able to be up on their frequency. And it's been life changing, you know, because you can sometimes isolate yourself because you feel like there's no more knowledge that you need to learn. And that's just kind of where I was at. And so when I opened up my mind to more new information, right, you know better, you do better, you're able to access these tools to work in your favor. And so that helps, along with, you know, obviously the power of manifestation and the power of confession, right, help you to move efficiently. So
So tell me a little bit about how you're more like, you if you came from a more monotheistic Christian background tradition, and then you move into these more esoteric ideas around, you know, chakra alignments and astrology, and, you know, and what you believe about God to be true or not true. Did you feel like you had to depart from your more traditional background, or did you merge it?
I feel like it was a merge, right? I always felt like monotheism or like Christianity wasn't cool, right? Like, to other people, right? My job is to make it look cool or to feel comfortable. And that's why me and Zamir connected, you know, in a very cool way, because I wasn't judgmental. I wasn't saying, you know, the fire and brimstone kind of message that had been put out there before. I was like, dude, you have some things that I can teach you, some things I can learn, and I have some things that I can teach you, and then we can get to the answer together. And so I feel like I was able to merge, and even able, you know, to speak about angel numbers and all these things, even in a space openly, because we all started going through it, right? Like, even people that have been, especially during the pandemic, right? We all started noticing these synchronicities and the chakra alignment and all that type of stuff. So then it wasn't like a weird thing, right? Now we're all kind of like, I feel like closer, because, you know, sometimes religion can be divisive. And so yet again, through conversation, I was able to eliminate the divisiveness of what religion might cause, and brought me and my, you know, my brother closer.
Right. And this is amazing. So you have also, you know, you feel like you have a mission here to, you know, be
a bridge, you know,
spiritually and gap the bridges, and specifically around, you know, your feelings towards spiritual work, right, and energy work, and all of that.
And the power of prayer, right? It was such a force between me and him. And we weren't from the same, you know, religious background, and we would pray with intention, right? And we talked about intentions and accountabilities and all these things that religion talks about, right? Yeah. But in a new, non-judgmental way, where we calling ourselves to accountability and to a deeper level of focus, right? And freedom, you know, yeah. from our past thoughts of like, we're going to kill this. No, we're going to bring this life, right? It was like, we had to really, and I'll talk about this later, we had to deprogram and reprogram
to be able
to go to the next level. And so, you know, the programming that we've been locked into for such a long time has kind of hindered us. So we had to go past all of that programming and get past our traumas, right? And break cycles. Mm-hmm. And we started making our music differently, and all these things stem from conversation.
Amazing. You're right. That's the power of the conversation. It's like our way to communicate and spread knowledge. And that's the chain reaction that leads to all of the transformational change that happens. I love that. And so you've mentioned your friend Zamir a couple of times. I think you do music together, and I did talk to him as well. And, you know, he comes from a Muslim background, and I also, come from a Muslim background. And, I think I told you a little bit about that, previously, but one of the things that I love that you're talking about is the way in which you didn't feel like you had to turn a cold shoulder to your belief system in like monotheistic God in order to have a togetherness with your new spiritual direction with different. See, some of these concepts, right, are like, oh, that's sinful. Or in Islam, it's like, oh, this is haram. This is not allowed. Right. This is like astrology is, you know, even tarot readings, you know, synchronicities and numbers. This is all going into the, you know, fortune tellers and the magic realm. Right. And that's very, you know, it's just still seen in that category of forbidden. And so I think a lot of us are really struggling with reconciling like traditional belief systems with like what's going on in reality right now. Like, right, I talk about ascension and these, you know, things. Well, what is that? Well, you know, the good thing is that ascension doesn't actually contradict like your belief in God, right?
Right. Yeah.
It's like the law of attraction, you know. And so now also the Muslim speakers and stuff, they're coming out with like, oh, you know, the power of dua, like the prayer for law of attraction. And so this is kind of the bridging over into this, you know, these monotheistic religions, right? With manifestation. And
the basic principle is like love for one another, right? And if you have love for one another, and that's like across all the boards, right? And unless you're like, usually it's like, I don't know. But when you have like everything is like rooted in some type of like, yo, as long as you have a common understanding and love for your brother or your sister, you can really get across these cultural lines or these spiritual lines very easily, because it comes from when you love someone, you come from a place of non-judgment. Okay, this is how you do this. Okay, well, this is how I do this. Okay, well, maybe there's a better way that we can find together, right? To make the world a better place. It's amazing when, like you said, you're able to understand each other's differences and then be able to ascend together.
Yeah, right. And you mentioned it being about love. I also, you know, everyone is like, yeah, it's a journey to the heart. It's a journey, you know, whatever you're doing, you know, finding, you know, your lens for the world. And like, for me, it became about empathy, you know, that's from the heart, and like understanding the other person and always using tools of empathy, to get out of your own like ego-based reality and into the, you know, the energy of what the other person or things outside of yourself that are important. So that to me is also very, you know, powerful, like flip of the switch that has to go on, you know, in someone's mind, right?
Right.
So when did you start your spiritual like journey? Like, what made you shift directions moving out of the industry that you were in?
I would say coincidentally, my whole life, obviously, I've been on a journey. But 2019, I was doing a lot of club promotion with celebrities, like all the time. You know, just the life, right? Like the rich and famous. Going to clubs and making money and da 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 and this and that. And coincidentally, it was one of the people I invited from LA, and he was like, dude, is this you? And I was like, what do you mean? Of course this is me. Like, you know what I mean? The ego, right? This is all me. I bring everybody out every weekend and I'm the guy and da-da-da-da. And God spoke to me and he's like, dude, like, do you want to lead people here to a dark place every single weekend? And I was like, oh, I guess I could see. And then, like, you know, that was the beginning of, like, I realized that I wasn't addicted to success. I was addicted to the applause.
Oh, attention. Yeah.
And the attention that. And like, oh, you're the guy. We're always going to see you. Oh, what's going on? Like, and I realized the moment that I got rid of my need of applause from the crowd, I was then able to lead people directly. And then that's when the whole Orange Collective thing. And I said, I wanted to save the world through music. And I met Zamir, and the whole kind of thing was to change the mission from a me-driven or an ego-driven thing of, you know, wanting to be the guy, so to speak, and lead people to a movement or a message. And that's been my journey in multitude of different ways.
Amazing. Yeah. It's like a journey of ego mastery, right? Where you have to look within, understand. It's like self-awareness comes with that. So many things, you know, come with that awareness. And you mentioned, so what was the band you created? The OC?
The Orange Collective, and it is the OC.
Orange Collective.
As you can see, like, I'm a big OC buff with everything that I create. It was just a group of just talented guys that we prayed. Like, it was just something that you probably will never witness again in history, when we broke so many barriers. It's that diverse, you know, band, obviously, with me and Zamir and the other gents that are a part of it. And we prayed together before every show. It was just insane, right? And we were able to break a lot of doors and barriers. We actually were able to do the Roscoe's Chicken and Waffle song together, and be able to do our opening at Nobu and of our album. And it was such an amazing time before the pandemic kind of came through, of what we were going to do and offer to society. And who knows, you know, the universe is always working in our favor, right? It's always our highest good. So for that season, it was such a bridge gapping thing for pop culture within Orange County and people that would witness us around the world. That we're together with non-judgment and non-ego, and able to just give people hope sonically.
Yeah, and break down those barriers, like you said, between culture, race, religion, you know, all social constructs that we want.
Exactly. It was the I call this the hip hop boy band, because you don't really have the hip hop.
Right? I love that.
It's, you know, everyone loved us, right? Because we weren't the typical, like, you have to look angry all the time, like, type of, like, pop guys and all that stuff. We were brotherhood, like a fraternity, and lifelong friendships forever, you know?
Yeah, amazing. And so now you're on to other things that are podcast related, right? You have, is this podcast experience coming up, and what are some of your initiatives?
Talk about it too much.
Yeah.
You know, the past 6 months have been such eye-opening. I was able to do stuff with, you know, some of the real housewives of Orange County, and, you know, some playmates, you know, that's in the industry, and just some really influential people I was able to do podcast experiences with, which led me to wanting to do something a little bit bigger and life-changing. And so working on building up, like, a podcast network of people and giving them platform, amplifying, you know, regardless of race, color, creed, religion. I want to amplify what you have to bring to the table. And so, like I said, these past 6 months have been eye-opening to what the power of podcasts can do for pop culture.
Oh, amazing. I love that. Well, I feel like I'm certainly catering towards increasing podcast awareness and listenership, and also like YouTube and other channels and avenues for artists to get, you know, work out and you get voices heard. And so also your TV, what is this? Tell me a little bit more about the reality show that
New OC is so funny, because me and my business partner, Jen, it's a manifestation in itself.
Great.
Literally 3 or 4 years ago, we were like, we should do a show called Entrepreneurs of OC. I was like, yeah, that would be awesome. Showcase what we do, da 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 da, this and that. And full circle, you know, last year, People were kind of seeing what I was doing, and they were like, I talked to some producers, and it was another name before called the Boys of OC. And then they were like, oh, that's kind of limiting. So then we were opened it up to being called the new OC, which coincidentally went in tandem with everything. It just makes sense.
It's your brand.
It's a brand. It makes sense. It's me. It's like, oh, okay, this is everything, right? It's not just one side. And so we have a great team putting it together. Shout out Deanna Land Productions. And we have great a cast of individuals that we've put together from just in diverse backgrounds and walks of life to just showcase that there's more than the housewives. There's a culture within Orange County that people need to see, of just normal people just working really, really hard and amazing things happening. And that's what I'm a proponent of. Like, I don't come from money. I just, the 10,000 hours thing, right? And I believe the power of belief, the power of faith. And you know, if you fail forward, you fail off, and eventually you're going to succeed.
Oh my gosh. Absolutely. Like, keep trying. Just keep swimming, right?
Yeah. Edison, right? The 99 times, the 98th time, if he would have stopped, he wouldn't have got it.
It's the charm. Right? Yeah. And so you're highlighting entrepreneurs. So like your average everyday folks that are struggling, but working businesses in Orange County. Is that the highlight of diversity and all of that?
Exactly. So we highlight that, but we put it together with, you know, the housewives, put it together with, like, so, you know, some selling OC or high-end individuals, right? So it's like, it has the duality of everything, but you're not just seeing one side of the coin, which is the amazing part that people want to be related to, right? The relatability of something. You know, if you're too removed from culture, that could be one's biggest downfall, is being removed from culture. And so I have the luxury, right, of being the anomaly that can fit into all these spaces that need there to understand where culture is at. So I'm not removed. And so staying in the grunt of things and constantly, you know, reinventing oneself and the constant work, the inner work that shows on the outer, you know, eventually, you know, works out itself.
Amazing. Yes. Well, and I love that now you've taken a direction that puts you on, you know, your mission-based path, and you are still able to have your, goals aligned with manifestation and with your, you know, Christian and monotheistic belief system. So that is amazing. And I was in law of attraction and now ascension. I was curious, what do you feel like when you talk to people about ascension or anything related to, how you improve your vibrational frequency? What do you say when people kind of ask you about your ideas?
I always say, because people are always like, man, did you make it look so easy? I always say, I constantly pray. I constantly am able to meditate. I'm also constantly understanding that even in the most, because I feel like sometimes in spirituality talk or like, you know, even Christian talk, we try to make things seem like it's so perfect. Like, even in the most darkest of times, and this is me speaking to myself, know, and I say it again, it's working out in your favor, in your highest good. And you literally have to tell yourself that, because situations don't feel like that. Like getting stabbed in the back, or like a partner, like, you know, turning their back on you, or switch up energy, as I like to call it, or, you know, people just acting differently. You really have to understand and keep your frequency high.
Definitely. Because,
and that comes from like images or what you're listening to, or people, even people influencing you can lower your frequency. So I gotta constantly check my frequency, my mentality, and my heart space to know that, you know, I'm coming from the best heart space, because I'm a leader. So what type of frequency I emit out there affects others. So constantly gotta check those three or four different spaces. And recently I really have been going to the gym.
Oh, nice. Like, well, that's like the self-care category.
The self-care, right? Because you can be the most spiritual guy, and then it's like, but there's something that you're dealing with because you have some issues of, you know, self-control issues, right?
Right.
And so how you do anything is the mirror, as we always like to say, is how you do everything. And so really just stepping it up, as my business partner Jen would say, just stepping it up in all areas of your life is, I feel like, my remedy right now for ascension. Open to new, and being open to new connections that weren't there, because sometimes we can be so closed off because we don't trust people, or like we don't know what their intentions are, right? But everyone's not out to get you, and so I had to like obviously like relearn that as well.
Yeah, amazing. And I definitely like that you brought up you know, things that you've had to improve in yourself, or that you've become aware of, like meditating. Are there things that you tell people like every day that you like to do, or that really help with this, with the process of manifestation and things like that for you?
I always tell them these are like some remedies, right? They're not the prescription for success, but these are just some of the remedies that I follow, right? Some of the things of praying, of meditating, of self talking to yourself in the mirror and telling yourself that you love yourself, right? A lot of men don't do that. And so I prescribe to that, you know, because we'll tell everyone else that we love them except ourselves. So really understanding your purpose and like finding out who you are, because a lot of us don't know who we are. So do you really like that? Or is it because you like someone else likes it that you like that? Are those ideas your original ideas, or are they copycatted ideas because like what you've seen before, what the programming of the matrix has given you? Really understanding who your personality and who you are, you know, as a person, and what you have to give to the world, right? Because we're all in service of something. And when I realized I'm in service, and I'm a producer of greatness, then I was able to move from that place.
Amazing. Yeah, it all starts from that place of, it's like you said, getting over your own limiting thoughts and beliefs and where that trauma came from, and all of that, and starting to unpack it all.
We'll be unpacking it for years and years, and if you think you have it, then something else will come up to be like, oh, that's a demon that you gotta decapitate internally. But once you're able to face those demons and look at them and smile, right? You're able to, you know, ascend even further.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, awesome. And so I want to let any of our listeners know, where can they find you? I know you're on Instagram, social media. Where should people go?
Yes, you can find me at Mayor of OC. Uh-huh. Mayor of OC. That's exactly how it sounds. And the new OC fan club is where you can find me as well. And then Classic Gen Inc. Those are my my main platform. Is the music is everywhere. You can find it, Mr. Fleming.
Yeah, all your music is up there.
All the vibes, all the different beach vibes, and all that cool stuff that we kind of bring to the taste palette.
Amazing. Okay, well, we'll have some links posted under this episode for all of your work. And do you have any other, you know, before we wrap, any final words for our listeners, or any last, you know, things that you'd like to?
It's okay if you don't have it, you know, figured out yet. Eventually you will, and don't overthink it.
Don't overthink it. Just do it.
Just do it. There is no spoon. There is no spoon in the matrix, right? Like there is no spoon. And we're here to find out. You're here because you already made the choice. Now you're here to find out why. I'm a big Matrix buff.
Matrix buff. There you go. Start quoting the Matrix. Break free of the Matrix.
Exactly.
I love it. Okay. Thank you so much, Will. Well, you know, that was an awesome episode. I'm glad we got to jump in a little bit into your background and your spiritual journey and the work that you're doing now. And I'm just excited to be connected. You have a great way of connecting people, conversations that change lives. And I already know we've been talking to a couple people, you know, that'd be good for my show. And I'm excited about the work you're doing, you know, for the podcasting industry. So I think this was fantastic. I'm so excited.
Hey, it was a breakthrough today. Thank you.
It was a breakthrough. I love that. Okay. Thank you so much, Will. You have a great day. And thanks for listening to this episode of Into the Light. And I'm your host, Edina Mauvana, and we'll talk to you next time. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye.